I wanted to see if I can get your take on a few things. One is in their reaction to what Garba Shehu said. Ohanaeze said essentially that the attempt by the federal government to blackmail IPOB that it has backfired. Do you happen to understand what that means and what they meant by that?
Well, you know, I've been the spectator in this, a lot of you know, exchanges everywhere about what the intention of this could be. It could well be that they have to call the dog a new bad name, Christian, Jews who are pushing the case for Christian and all of that. They may just be trying to arrange themselves in a manner that prepares the ground for something else they want to do with their friends who are chanting Biafra all over the place. What the LNC set out to do is to bring this matter to where everybody is on the table in a transitional process, the type South Africa did with apartheid in 1990. That's where we're driving the matter to. It's an option for everybody to embrace that sensible solution. But if they feel that it is guns that will solve the matter, you know, I don't see, they could be laying foundation for all kinds of mischief. That's up to them. But there's a solution to the problem at hand. Even in their agitations, whether it is IPOB that's agitating for Biafra, or the Niger Delta Avenger or men that is agitating for resource control, or the OPC that picked up arms against security in Yoruba land and talking about regional autonomy, or the ones in the middle belt who cannot understand why they are being killed and they cannot touch guns. Everything revolves around constitutional grievances that can be settled in a civilized way in the 21st century. And what the LNC and its MNN alliance partners have done is to provide a framework within which this matter can be resolved, other than we heading to Somalia, because Nigeria is not working. And if anybody is hoping that the 68 items on the exclusive list will remain there, and all our assets are detained, and our right to work those assets, we cannot generate electricity for ourselves, we cannot transmit, we cannot even elect those who will govern us, because there is some INEC in Abuja, in a federation. What is INEC in Abuja doing in a federation? You saw what happened in Imo. You saw what has already come out of it, that elections were conducted in a state. Imagine that in your New York, that you finish elections and somebody is sworn in, and several months into the tenure, somebody in wherever, some Supreme Court in Washington now turns up and says that the man who came fourth in the election is the winner. And then a party that is connected and affiliated with this terror we're talking about, the APC, is now in charge in Imo. And you can see what that governor has done there so far, bringing in this suspicious populations of strange Fulani elements from outside Nigeria, relocating, welcoming them, and trying to settle them in the place. So these things are matters. They are so straightforward. If we want to solve them, we go and sit down and solve them. But if anybody is hoping that constitution that make any union impossible, because we settled, we agreed to be a secular union in Lancaster House. We agreed to be a democracy in Lancaster House. It's no longer possible to be secular union where 12 contiguous states have passed Sharia. You can show the map, and in that Sharia, democracy has become impossible. Those who do not hold human life sacrosanct like we do, those who owe it a duty of faith to kill the infidel, which is the rest of us, the adherents of Sharia owe it a duty of faith to kill the infidel. And we're saying that there has been a departure, which is why we're targeting that constitution for taking it down. There has been a departure from the fundamental basis of being in one union. If we thought we were building a secular union and you went and imposed Sharia unilaterally, if we thought we were building a democratic union and you imposed Sharia that is mixed up with feudalism, all of those are mutually exclusive with constitutionalism and democracy. And we cannot offer our life. Our assets have been taken. The oil and gas have been taken from the eastern part, the port of Lagos and all the proceeds, more than 2 trillion in 1 year, taken away from the owners. Everything has been taken from everybody. The right to carry guns and arms to defend yourself from armed invaders, you know, somebody is still hoping to sit on it and tell us, you know, what has to happen. And then we just fold our arms and watch them kill off to the last person. It's not going to happen. That constitution will go down, and the union, the unitary union, is forced on all of us who have to get back to being discussed.
Okay, let me say this. We will extend in the next few days invitation to Nnamdi Kanu of IPOB and Garba Shehu, the speaker, the spokesman for the government, to come and talk to us.
Yes.
But let me ask you this. I know that the core of the your organization is to bring down the Constitution of Nigeria. How do you, what's the next move, knowing that most political actors in Nigeria are basically thinking about 2023 election, who is going to be president? There is this group in Ohanaeze saying that it's the turn of the Igbo, the Yorubas are saying that seems to be where most of the political actors are at this point. How are you going to make that inroad in this kind of environment?
The owners, I'm sure you noticed the solemn assembly of the peoples of the Lower Niger that happened in Port Harcourt in 2015. Where the nationalities of the eastern half of southern Nigeria gathered to say that they were fed up with this constitution, that they will not tolerate that constitution as basis of the union, and that they will do whatever they can to exercise their right to self-determination if the rest of the country does not listen. Then I'm sure you also remember that on the 7th of September in 2017 at Adamawa Igba Stadium in Ibadan, that the Yoruba came out in their numbers with their governors present, with their traditional institutions present, including the Oni of Ife. What was it they were saying? That they will not accept that they repudiated the 1999 constitution as basis of the union, and that they will not accept further business being done under it. On the 18th of July in 2018, the same thing happened in Makurdi. Remember the day they wouldn't allow plane carrying Modo and Edwin Clark to land in Makurdi. The day, that was the day the Middle Belt. And when you look at the map of the alliance between the three, you will see that if these three blocks, in rejection of the Sharia that have been imposed by the other bloc, are saying that this constitution can no longer be, then a few people who, because they want to be governor and senator or president, will go from amongst them, because whoever wins the election, we are not bothered about the party color or what they are promised. Whoever wins the election will have to swear to defend and uphold that constitution that is was an apartheid constitution. And so, those people who gather in Abuja, we've been talking to them quietly. We probably will have to raise our voices a little more. The people from southern and middle belt Nigeria, the politicians from southern and middle belt Nigeria, who gather in Abuja, whether they already have sworn to defend and uphold that constitution that they torment their people and cause death and poverty to them, or they are still planning to contest elections in 2023 or whenever, to that will end up with them swearing to defend and uphold that constitution. I can assure you, they are such a hopeless minority. I can assure you, they are going to have to be accountable to their own people who are being killed under that constitution. It's like in apartheid South Africa, a group of blacks now finding some benefit under the apartheid. At the time, a majority. 20 years ago, I was alone in saying we can't carry on with this constitution. 10 years ago, quite a number of people had come, but it hasn't become a critical mass. As of today, more than 3/4 of the country are now together on one side, rejecting that constitution. That minority that thinks it will overpower these 3/4 of the country and drag us to another election under that constitution will have two problems. The people, you know, Abuja has become, I will call it, for want of how else to describe it, has become, an aggregation of regional renegades, a refuge ground for regional renegades. The peoples of southern Nigeria and middle belt Nigeria are being tormented by people from the other part who are directly responsible. You saw what Mietiala have been saying. You saw what Mietiala have been doing. And people who are their grand patrons are there watching. They are now threatening that they will rule forever because they are born to rule. They are killing people in these numbers, and there's nobody in government that is calling them to order. And so the constitution by which they empower themselves is what we're discussing here. Like the apartheid constitution empowered the Boers. Imagine if there was any black that went to make benefit to go and contest election under the apartheid constitution at a time Mandela and Oliver Tambo and the rest were fighting to take down the apartheid constitution, because that's what we're doing now, to take down this constitution that seize the assets of everybody and render everybody slaves in their land. Those people from these places where this ethnic cleansing is being targeted, the people being killed in Middle Belt are going to hold accountable the politicians from their midst who are sustaining that constitution that empowered that enemy that is killing them. The peoples of Eastern Nigeria and or Lower Niger, including the Niger Delta, are going to hold accountable, are going to have a fight with people from their places who go to join hands with the enemy to sustain that constitution. The same thing with in Yoruba land. And in that kind of a setting, the enemy that if things break down today, the enemy, the number one enemy that will be target, legitimate target, for those who are being killed and those who are being tormented across the South and Middle Belt are those people from their places who have been sustaining that constitution that should have gone down a long time ago. Because if they were not going to join hands with the people who imposed that constitution to continue the treason that had been committed in throwing away the constitutions we agreed upon and imposing another that we never discussed under the pretense that we enacted it, those people from Southern Nigeria and Middle Belt, whether they belong to PDP or APC or DAPGA, whichever party, what they are doing is aiding the enemy against their people, aiding the enemy that is killing their people against their people, aiding the enemy that is impoverishing their people against their people. And for every further business they seek to do under that 1999 constitution, which bring humongous personal benefits to them, because there's a reason they are doing so. They want to make the benefit. They want to make money. They want to make fame. That's the reason they don't mind that their people are being killed under that constitution. If that constitution is removed today, if they agree with their people that constitution should go down, that matter will not take more than 1 week to solve. Therefore, it is the politicians from the South and the Middle Belt that are actually sustaining this torment. Yeah, that constitution is standing because there are people from these places who go to sit with them in Abuja. We have actually come to the point where they have to make a choice between sizing up with their people who have repudiated that constitution, who do not want any further business under that constitution, so that they can defend themselves, because it is that constitution that is tying their hands. It's that constitution that took out their assets.
Now, let me ask you, because people who are listening to you might ask this question, you know. A good example is Imo State. Imo State is where people saw what happened there. And the people of Imo State did not rise up to say, we are not going to accept this. That somebody who came forth in an election ended up being announced as the winner of the election. People didn't rise up. And people who were in the party that was the one in power before the judgment of the Supreme Court, they immediately switched to the party of APC. And people did nothing. So how do you explain to people who are listening to you that there will be something that will happen now that will make the people to say, we are going to hold these people accountable, people who are representing us, for not doing much or anything to stop or follow what you are saying, or even to stop what is going
on?
What do you say
you see, when you choose to do monkey business, as we say in our palace, anybody who goes contesting election under that constitution in which one headman can sit in Abuja and declare another result several 1 year after an election has been conducted, whatever you see is just like going to join a robbery gang or a kidnapping gang, and then you begin to complain about how police slapped you when they grab all of your what. Anything happening amongst them is something that can happen under that constitution, which is why we say, let us not go into any further electoral business under that constitution. You saw even the primaries. in which somebody from somewhere would just go to one hotel and do something. That's somebody from outside the territory entirely. You saw when they were looking, have you seen Gulag? Have you seen Gulag? Did you not hear about it in Nowere? So in all of that, the LNC is looking at all of them as members of the same large gang, wearing different jerseys. They are in one business. And that's why I was saying that the enemy will not be the one from afar. The enemy will be those our brethren who are doing this electoral business under this constitution, because that is what is sustaining that constitution. That is what is sustaining the torment and the impoverishment of their people. It is that constitution over and above everything else. So in their numbers, in their minority numbers, they could go from one PDP to one APC or another APGA. In the eyes of those who have been killed, in the eyes of those who have been tormented under this constitution, they are all the same. And when the chips are down, they will be the first target for the people who are being killed when they begin to push back. We are the ones standing between them who are being tormented, them who are being killed, and all of what they should have been doing in self-help. We are persuading them. You remember, we started with Pronaco, where we called the whole country together to say, including those who are already carrying arms, they are starting the cobbles of this world, and the men and all the others that came after them, the Wazirikes of the time, the Ghanaians that had an armed OPC, we persuaded all of them to come to the conference in which we put the sovereignty question on the table. Gentlemen, the British are gone now. Is it not possible for us to work out what can become the basis of a stable union, of a progressive union? The one we have is not working. The impositions we have failed. And the union is under the threat of disorderly disintegration. My concern is not the disintegration. My concern is the disorderly disintegration that may follow when people continue to kill people in the manner we have seen. And when people, when are killed, when assets are resourced, being told that the people who have come to do all of that are born to rule them, that if anybody who doesn't come along in their faith will be infidel, to be killed and treated the way we have seen. And so we have painstakingly organized everybody in a manner that becomes a process to answer those constitutional questions arising from the constitutional grievances being expressed. And we have come now to where there's a majority that is not going to bother with that minority, whether they are from geographically in one part or they are political party people trying to go to get one more benefit under that constitution. Our target is that constitution. Anybody found on the side of that constitution will be the first victim of the pushback against that constitution.
Okay, let me ask you one question. I know that people watching this will be thinking about. So, say year from now, the APC, they come together and agree that Bola Tinubu should be their candidate for president.
Yes.
How are you going to convince majority of Yoruba people that you turn their back on Tinubu because of the 1999 constitution, and then let him just hang in there and not support him for this election coming up in 2023.
I can assure you. I'm sure you saw the Yoruba World Congress that went to United Nations unrepresented people's organization. Matters have moved far away from what the picture you are painting. The Yoruba, you also remember that I'm not just a secretary general of the Lower Niger Congress, I'm also co-convener of that movement for New Nigeria, which has now become Movement for No Nigeria, from the point Sharia, was imposed in the arena. We were thinking we could just ease out that constitution and bring everybody to a common vision bound by common morality, with sanctity of human life at the center and equal opportunity because all men are born equal. Those four items, those who cling onto their Sharia and their feudalism and the unitary constitution they imposed in advancement of their own objectives, they brought matters to where we now said, well, if we cannot find common ground, then what is available to all of us is the right to self-determination, which we believe the exercise at the point remember it was the 12 contiguous states of the far north that passed Sharia simultaneously in the year 2000. Their state assemblies individually passed the law, and their governors signed the law into place and began to set up execution in terms of the Hizba, the Sharia police. So we reckon what they did as a secession from the secular union we were building, as a secession from the democratic union we thought we were building with them. And you remember when the Boko Haram still had time to issue bulletins, Boko Haram expressly rejected democracy, rejected constitution, rejected all of those things that we hold sacrosanct. And if human life is not held sacrosanct, and democracy is not to be the basis of our constitutionalism, then they have seceded from the union we were building, and that they did so in exercise of their right to self-determination. That right to self-determination, we don't quarrel about how they exercise their own. The right to self-determination also accrues to us, and it's not dependent on what Nigeria thinks. You understand? We've gone to the UN. We know exactly what's available to us. The problem all the while had been, who will organize everybody in a manner that will enable them to exercise that right? That has been done, and that is what the MNN alliance has succeeded in bringing to the table. Even if Buhari resigns today to say, oh, so that things will be where they are, let me resign, let somebody from Yoruba land or the other one from the East become the replacement for me, so that there can be, I'm talking about resigning and handing over power without election. Even if that happens, even if that is put on the table today, I can assure you that those whose eyes are on that constitution to take it down will not pay any attention to all of the politicians who are hanging around that constitution to make benefit for themselves. Jonathan was president for 6 years. Did he change the affairs of the job in the constitutional grievances that led to the agitation? Obasanjo was president for 8 years. Did he change anything in the affairs of the Yoruba? Has it elevated any one of them above what Abiola became in the eyes of these people? Why was Abiola killed? Because the slave cannot rule over the house of his master. From independence to date, which Yoruba man has become controller general of the cost of customs that collect more than 2 trillion from Lagos port? Who owns that? Who owns the water, the land and the water, aborting it? So you see, it's not a matter of which party will go to get what benefit. We've been at it for 20 years, since 1999, 21 years now. What benefit has it brought to anybody? So we have that majority. Those who have been tormented. Nigeria has become the poverty capital of the world for a Nigeria that sells over 3 million barrels of crude oil every day with unquantifiable human resources scattered all over the world. I travel around and I see Nigerians who are in economic exile. They're just like refugees in various countries. You see what's happening with them in the US. And so we say to those who are making it impossible for them to function at home, it is that constitution that makes electricity impossible. I didn't want to talk about Abakari and whatever happened. What was it that, if I tell our people today that it is that constitution that consumed Abakari, they will think I'm stretching it. But you remember what he went to do in Germany? You leave electricity generation and transmission on the exclusive list. Then you go to Germany to look for Siemens to come and build electricity for who? Remove electricity from exclusive list and wait for 6 months and see whether we do not have 50,000 megawatts of electricity in the pipeline that will be delivered by those who have to use that electricity.
Mr. Tony,
as it is with electricity, with so many other things. So what we are saying is that constitution must go down. All of those who are hanging on it to go to another election under it are going to have to contend with their people who are suffering under that constitution. Those who are being killed in the middle belt, it is that constitution that tied their hands to their backs, where strangers can come to shoot them and kill them and take their lands. All of those who are complaining about other things, we have organized them. They are now in formations. They can become countries of their own if there's no common ground found in Nigeria. And if anybody is hoping to have another season, the 4 years they have now that will expire in 2023 is more than enough time for us to resolve this matter. But we can assure you that anyone who says he wants to go and contest election from among, I'm not talking about state elections, the ones that are too close already, we are not bothered with them. Let nobody mix it up. We are talking about 2023 election. Anybody from the South and the Middle Belt that is planning to go and contest election is telling his people that, look, I am for that enemy that has imposed this calamity on you. I don't care whether all of you die. I want to be president. I want to be governor. I want to be senator. They are going to be, when I talk about accountability, it's not the matter for whenever. They are going to be confronted sooner than they can imagine by those who are facing the torment flowing from that constitution.